Bill Keller. As Jennifer eloquently said, I'm with Tri-Life Commercial. I am a real estate broker. And most people in here are probably sole proprietors or independent contractors, correct? There may be a few employees, but I'm an independent contractor. I am not a Tri-Life employee. As I like to say, I only get to eat what I kill, meaning that I'm a commission-based salesperson. I am my own business, meaning that I get up every day thinking about how am I going to make my next paycheck? How am I going to do that? And a lot of it has to do with the type of service that I provide. And now here's a test question. Susan Hines, who works with me, substituted for me last week. I was out of town. And in her one-minute presentation, what was the number one thing that a real estate broker does? What is their goal? Anybody remember? Anybody listening?
Sale.
It's to bring people together for a mutually beneficial outcome. That is what a broker does. A broker does things that you do not want to do or you don't have the ability to do. Think about it. Anytime you've ever used a broker, it's because you needed them to do something for you that you really didn't want to mess with or you didn't know how to do it. That's what a real estate broker does. And you want to have somebody that's competent, expert in their field, just like Sherry is in her field, I am in my field, that they're going to make sure that if they're going to trust you to help them reach their goals, you got to know what you're doing. All right, let's go ahead and go to the next thing, please. So what is it? Commercial real estate, it consists of primarily retail. That could be strip centers. It could be an 800-square-foot bay in a strip center. It could be a shopping center. It could be a storefront. Industrial. We'll get into that a little bit more. There's different types of industrial property. Office. That could be a complex. It could be a little standalone office building. Chandra, I sold a little office building that they occupy on Center Street in Collierville a couple years ago to them. Multifamily, which is four units or more, or commercially designated land for development, and it depends on the zoning. Does it have retail, commercial mixed-use zoning? Does it have industrial zoning? Any other type of commercially-based zoning? All right, next one, please. So who are my clients and prospects? Primarily, obviously, existing property owners who want to sell their property, or existing property owners who want to lease their property, or as I said in my 1 minute, somebody who wants to get rid of their debt and stay in their building, but just become a tenant instead of an owner. Investors looking to purchase. Again, those are the people who would buy those types of properties. They're looking for an income stream. So if you're an owner-user, you're more focused on the building. Does it suit your needs? An investor is going to look at, does the cash flow meet my goals? So if I'm looking for a 9% return on investment, if that property is generating that and it's got a good quality tenant in it, well, I may be interested in that. Or maybe my goal is a 10% return on investment. Maybe I'm looking for some low-risk investments and I'm willing to do a 6% return on investment. For example, like a Dollar General store. Got a 20-year lease on it, national quality tenant. They're not going anywhere. Check's going to come every month. Very low risk. Well, I don't need a 9% anymore. Maybe I'll do a 6%. I'm looking for buyers looking to purchase industrial property, flex property. I'll get into that a little bit. Office buildings, standalone complexes, develop or developable land, again, with zoning. Got to make sure that the zoning fits the use. And also real estate auctions, people looking to liquidate property. So my clients and prospects, obviously the number one one is other realtors. I get tons of business from other realtors, mainly Tri-Life ones, but I get them from outside of Tri-Life. We're by far the largest company. They are customers. They talk to people. They're meeting people just like you are every day. They're my number one source of referrals. I didn't even put them on there. It goes without saying. But I'm looking, obviously, for property owners. I'm looking for tenants, either existing tenants or people who want to be tenants in a property. Existing tenants may want to renegotiate their lease. They may want to relocate to them. If they want them to upsize, they want to downsize, or maybe just relocate to a better area. Certainly willing to work with them. Attorneys, trustees, these are people that are dealing with people that own real estate. They may have some needs. And also on the auction side, charity groups, fundraising groups, Anybody that needs help raising money, I generally do that pro bono. I don't charge. There's only a couple that I do. For example, I'm doing one here in a couple of weeks for Delta Waterfowl. I make them tens of thousands of dollars. So I ask for a little bit of money. But Cystic Fibrosis, St. Jude, Ronald McDonald House, hey, that's a great cause. Street Dog Foundation, very near and dear to me. So I don't charge for that service. All right, market served. Next slide. Tennessee, Arkansas, Mississippi. I'm also licensed as an auctioneer in all three of these states. So in my also being a CCIM, which is a commercial investment member, I have a referral network as well within CCIM. So if you had a client or had somebody that you knew that had a building in Texas that they wanted to sell, you could come to me and say, hey, I've got somebody that needs help in Texas, say Dallas, Texas. I can find them a competent CCIM for whether it's office, industrial, retail. I can find them a competent CCIM and put them together and help them sell their property. All right, next slide, please. Types of properties that I deal with, the top two mainly are industrial flex and office flex. Industrial flex is it's a minimal amount of office, mostly warehouse. So 20% office, 80% warehouse. Office flex is just the opposite, 80% office, 20% warehouse. So that's what we mean by flex space. Retail, as we talked about, it could be a standalone bay and a strip center. It could be a shopping center. It could be storefront retail, all types. Anything dealing with retail or just general commercial use. Multifamily, we talked about. Land, again, depending upon whether it's raw land or developed land, what's the zoning for that? What's the use? Are there any restrictions? There's a lot of things that go into that. And again, that kind of gets back to the brokerage. You want to deal with somebody that's competent and knowledgeable, and we also have to abide by a code of ethics. You have to be an expert in your field. If you're not an expert, you don't need to, because you are not putting the client's needs first. You're putting your own first, but you're just trying to get a paycheck instead of actually taking care of the client. So you've got to know what is standard practice, and that's why people, again, use a broker, because you're a professional. You know the market. You know what are the standard norms and standard practices in that industry. How many people know whether or not, if you're buying a piece of property, do you pay the deed transfer tax or not? Now, what's the standard in this industry or in this market? For example, if I sold a $1 million piece of property and I'm representing my seller and they put it in the contract that the seller is going to pay the deed transfer tax, you have any idea how much a deed transfer tax is on a $1 million piece of property? Mm-hmm. It could be $10,000. Yeah. So if you don't know that, if you don't understand that, what is acceptable in this market, it could cost you. All right, next slide, please. All right, real quick about the auction. Seller has a defined need, meaning that you don't sell at auction. It either works or it doesn't work. Time is money. They either have personal, financial issue, they're motivated. And I have the five D's there. Death, divorce, stress, disease, and debt. Mainly distress. People may inherit property. It's been vacant for a long time. They don't have or don't want to put the money into it. They want out. An auction is a great way to do that. So why sell at auction? It gives the seller leverage. Other than just putting it out there on the market and hoping that somebody nibbles. This puts buyers on notice that, hey, I'm selling this property on a certain day at a certain time. If you want it, and if there's demand for it, they'll show up and they'll buy it. It's always sold as is. Seller sets all the terms and conditions. The buyer pays the commission. Seller doesn't have to pay the commission anymore. It's a compressed sales window and puts that property out front and puts it in the spotlight. So it forces any potential buyers. So qualifying sellers, you know, motivation is key. Seller is anxious, ready to move on. So those trigger words, you know, I need help selling, or I'm looking to buy, you know, I'm in a crunch, I need to lease something, I need to buy something, I need help. Those are great trigger words. How's the property position? I look at all of that. I look at the risk tolerance for auctions. You know, you want to sell or you want to try? they gotta have to have a full understanding of the auction process. They have to understand that the marketing is key and the message you send across is powerful because you've got to get people to respond. And that's the bottom line. So an auction, you can't sell it. There's got to be a need. If there's not a need, then the auction process doesn't work. They might as well just put it on the market. Identifying properties, current supply of like properties, the level of demand, what's the financial position of the property that the owner has. If there's debt service on the property, I can't sell it absolutely. Because guess what? The bank's going to say, if it doesn't bring that, you know, what they owe on it, they're not going to let it go. Valuation estimates of the current market. You know, what's the expectation of the owner versus what the real market condition is? Are we in sync here? Do we have something that's workable? What's the property condition? Is it vacant, distressed, is it in good condition? You have to take that into consideration as to what you think the market will bear. And is it positioned for an investor or an owner user? Those are all things I take into consideration for an auction. And that's pretty much it in a nutshell. I know we got a little bit of time. Anybody have any quick questions?
With your experience, someone, let's say like myself, is not quite into a brick and mortar building. With your experience, would you be able to help someone, let them know if they were ready for that before they go into the long process or looking? That way, you know, we're not wasting time. But again, you know, someone like myself, we don't know. Well, yeah, of course, we want to, but we just don't know if we're ready or not.
Well, the first thing I'll do is I'll ask what your budget is. You know, what can you tolerate on a monthly basis? And then obviously look at the property type. And then what I can do is I can search the market and say, okay, you know, one thing that I can do is that if you give me a wish list, give me your critical list and then give me your wish list, I'll try to match up as many of those as I can, and I could do a query search where I could say, okay, here's what's out there right now. These are probably the best